Hi everyone. So today we will talk about object-oriented programming. Let me share my screen. So until now, we actually learned a type of programming called procedural programming, in which you have methods and you have a single main method that you execute sequentially. And sometimes you call other methods, that's method abstraction, in which case you basically execute that method, return back to the caller. So this is what is generally known as imperative programming. And the type of programming that we discussed basically up to now, the seventh week of classes is procedural programming, because everything is based on methods and is only method execution. We talked about loops, we talked about selections, if statements, and all the sequential execution of programs. Today we'll continue with another kind of programming called object-oriented programming. And Java is particularly important for object-oriented programming. It's not the first object-oriented programming language. The first one was Smalltalk, but it's definitely one of the most used object-oriented programming systems that actually developed this entire area of software engineering with object-oriented programming. The opening problem, actually, that Smalltalk, the first object-oriented programming language, started with were graphical user interfaces and GUIs. And graphical user interfaces are usually formed out of components. You basically use a framework that gives you various types of components, graphical user interface components. So for instance, you build usually a standalone desktop application with a graphical user interface that has multiple buttons, multiple input fields, multiple checkboxes, choice boxes, lists, and so on. And the idea is that you actually have instances, multiple instances of the same type of object. And you set some properties of these objects. Like for instance, you set the color of the button, the form of the button, the font of the button. These are multiple properties that give you the state of the button. Now, it's not the case that Java or Smalltalk were the first programming languages that use this kind of structured data that has an object that has multiple data fields. In fact, before that in C, there were structures. However, there was one feature that was added by object-oriented programming, which is behavior. That is not only that you have a group of properties together, but also that you have methods that you can invoke for that object. So for instance, consider that you want to represent people into a database. And for that, one can develop a class, which is one of these templates that allows you to add multiple properties. Like for instance, first name, last name, date of birth, and so on. Now, a method that would work for such a class person would be get age. So based on the birth date of that specific person and the current date, it would compute the age of that specific person. So an object in object-oriented programming doesn't only contain the state of the object, but also it offers methods that can be invoked to return values relative to that state. So we'll start discussing today about object-oriented programming concepts, and then we'll see how to implement these in Java. Feel free at any moment to ask me questions, either in the chat or just unmute yourself to ask the question. So in object-oriented programming, an object represents an entity in the real world that can be distinctly identified. Like for instance, if you have a person class, an object could be person Paul, person John, person Bill, and so on. Now, an object has a unique state and behavior. So the state is the set of all the data fields of that object. So for instance, person Paul has first name Paul, last name Fodor, and so on. So basically you have a set of data fields and their corresponding values. In addition to this set of data fields and their values, you have the behavior of the object, which is defined by a set of methods. These are the called the instance methods for the class. You call the method, let's say, for instance, get first name, and you return the first name of that object. Similarly, you call the method get age, and you return the age of that object. Now, object-oriented programming is good for multiple reasons. One is that it lets you develop a structured way to store your data in objects that have all the same standardized data fields. And also, you have methods that can be invoked for that object, but also the fact that they are easy to explain to customers. So in software engineering, there is a systematic visual language called UML, Unified Modeling Language, that actually allows software engineers or programmers like us, developers, to actually communicate to our customers or to other software engineers what are the objects, what are the structures, the data structures in our classes. So here we have such an example. We have a class template. This is a class diagram in UML that contains the name of the class. In this case, it's a circle. The circle has data fields, for instance, the radius as a double. You can have other data fields like, for instance, if it's field, that's that circle, was the coordinate X and Y for the circle, was the color of the circle, and so on. So the set of data fields, those are, that is the state of the object. And then you have methods that can be invoked for that specific object. So getArea. GetArea will be basically one method that invoked for different objects of the type circle, it will return different areas corresponding to the radius of every one of those circles. Also in UML, you can represent objects. So you see, you can represent classes using the class name, the data fields and the methods. And then you can represent objects like circle object one, which has a radius of 10, circle object two that has a radius of 25, circle object three that has a radius of 125. The method getArea is invoked for each one of them. So for circle one, you would basically get area of a circle of radius of 10. For circle two, you would get the getArea would return the area of a circle with radius of 25. And for a circle object three, you return the area of an object of radius of 125. So classes in Java are for two reasons. Until now, we saw that a class is basically a program in Java. If it has a main method, it's basically a way to group the main method and other methods used by the main method. But in Java, a class is also a template that can be used to define objects of the same type. So for instance, you can define a class circle with data fields, radius, color, field of the type Boolean, and so on. And then that class would allow you to basically use variables for the data fields and methods, instant methods, non-static methods to define the behavior of that of objects of that specific class. One thing that we will see is that a class provides a special type of method that in Java has no return type. Basically, it's what it returns is an object of that class, an object instance of that class. These specific type of methods are called constructors. They have the same name with the class itself. There might be multiple constructors you may have with different arguments overloaded constructors, which are invoked to construct objects of that class. And in fact, we have used them before when we used, let me actually open a notepad to show you that we use these constructors. For instance, when we defined string variables as one, and we said that this is a new string, and then we passed in the string, like for instance, hi. So what we actually invoke here with the new operator is actually the constructor for the class string. So the class string is a class in Java that has basically a constructor that takes another string and creates a string with that string. Similarly, we also used it when we define scanners. So remember that we said scanner input or in is a new scanner. And then we passed in the system input string. So basically, this tells us that this scanner is actually the constructor for that class scanner. In the Java API, there is a public class scanner, and the class scanner has one of the constructors is public scanner that takes a system input stream. Input stream as in, or just in, and then it has some implementation, okay, which creates a scanner for that specific input stream. There are many different constructors. For instance, when we will see later that the scheme scanner can be actually used to read from files. So actually you can use, there is a constructor that takes a file as an input and it creates a scanner for that specific file object, okay? And similarly for string, basically there is somewhere in the Java API, in Java lang package, there is a class string and it has a constructor takes another string as a parameter, in fact, and it creates an object of the type string. So again, it has some implementation internally, and we will do something similar for our own classes, okay? So let's see an example. Let's start with a simple example. For instance, I want to develop a paint application. And in this paint application, I want to draw circles, and I have multiple circles that I want to draw in that paint application. So I can create the class circle. So the class circle has a data field, private double radius, that is equal with 1.0, the default value for radius. It has multiple constructors. The first constructor, public circle, has no parameters and returns a circle with a default radius of 1.0. And then public circle that takes a double new radius and assigns to the data field radius instead of 1.0, the new radius that is passed as a formal parameter. And we have other methods. These are instance methods, public double get area that returns the radius square multiplied with pi. You can already see that none of these methods is static. They are not, you cannot call them with the class. You can't say circle dot get area. You actually have to call it for a specific circle, like circle one, C1 or C2. Okay. And here is an example. Test circle as a main method in which I define two circles, circle C1, which is a circle with a default radius of one, and circle C2, that is a new circle with a radius of 5.0. And now for this circle, C1 and C2, I can invoke the get area method, or I can get the data field radius if the data field radius wouldn't be private. So that's basically one thing, that if it's private, I actually need to get it with a specific method. It's called an accessor or a get method. I will actually implement this so you can actually see how is this implemented. And I will tell you what private means. So private means, so basically, let me show you and then you will understand why we want it as private. So let's do exactly this behavior that we implemented here. So in my Eclipse, I will create a new class circle. So basically the new class circle has a data field. I'm going to define it default modified, not private, radius, which has a default value of one. Then I have multiple constructors, so I can define public circle that has no parameters. It creates a circle with basically exactly a circle with radius of one, the default radius. And I have public circle that takes a double new radius and assigns to the radius data field, because it's in the same object, the new radius. Now I have a multiple methods, public, double get area that returns the area of a circle with that given that radius. So we return radius square multiplied with 3.14159, an approximation of pi. Maybe we can implement more methods. So public double get diameter, and diameter returns to multiply with radius and so on. We can implement get perimeter and so on, to radius multiply with pi and so on. Okay, so now we can implement a class that uses circles. So we can create a new class test circle. So I had the class circle with its constructors, and I'm going to create here multiple circles and then use them separately as individual objects. So I can create a circle C1, and for C1, I'm going to use the default constructor. And for C1, I can actually now see what's the value of radius. Then I can call the method get area, maybe the method get diameter, and so on. And similar to C1, I can create another circle. So I can create circle 2. And maybe circle 2 doesn't have a default radius of 1, but a radius of 2. And for C2, I can get its radius, diameter, area, and diameter. So I can run this program. And I see that I have two circles. I have a circle that has a radius of 1, an area of 3.14159, because it's 1 square multiplied with 3.14159. And then diameter is 2.0. Then I have a second circle, C2, and C2 add a radius of 2, a diameter of 4, and an area of 12.56636. Okay. Now, one question that somebody asked was, why do I define this as being private? And I can show you first, what's the problem? Why you want it private? So having access to it, I can modify it in any way I want from outside the class. So I can create a circle with negative radius, minus 2, which makes no sense. Basically, I shouldn't be able to create circles with negative radius, because that's basically that such circles do not exist. So what is usually done? Data fields are defined as private. Private means that from other classes, I cannot access them. So basically, this means that I cannot assign to radius minus 2. Now, since the data field is private and I want to have sometimes the value of that data field, Then I must implement what are called accessor and mutators methods. So yes, the data field radius is private, but I can define a public method, double get radius, that can return a copy of the radius, because in this case it's a primitive value. So I can return the radius, and that's basically just a value. So now from the other method, I can actually call the method get radius instead of using directly the data field radius. And similarly, I'm going to do this here. So now I can access it. But now you would ask, okay, you can access it, but sometimes you want to modify it. You want to write something of the kind C1 dot set radius to 3. And that's okay. That basically means that I must implement another method, public void set radius, in which I can actually make tests. So here I get a double new radius, but only if the new radius is positive, then I will initialize the radius with the new radius. So the advantage of this is that I don't let the user to modify my radius always. Like for instance, maybe a user would try to create a circle with negative radius, but that will not actually modify the circle. Will actually, that would be completely meaningless. So the code will still have the radius of 3. And I, as an external user, I cannot modify, I can't make a circle of radius of -4. So that's why usually data fields are defined as private. And then in inside classes, you have what are called get methods or getters and setters. They're also called accessors and modifiers. And similarly for set methods, modifiers. Okay. Why do we need a circle without parameters? Because usually, one thing is that you want to create default circles. Maybe I want through the API to create a circle, and I don't want to pass it a default value. And again, it maybe doesn't make sense sometimes to have a circle with radius of 0. Okay, so it makes sense to have what are called default empty body constructors. Sometimes, let's say that I want to, I have additional data fields here. I have private color of the type string, and I want to always to create circles that are red. So a default constructor would let me to use that constructor from anywhere. Like for instance, in the second constructor, I can invoke the default constructor. So code that is in common to all constructors can be put into that default constructor, and all of the other constructors are going to call it. Now you see here this call, this keyword, this. So this is a reference to the current object. Is used for two different reasons. The first reason is if you want to call another constructor from a constructor as the first call. So here I'm calling the no argument constructor for circle from the circle constructor that takes a radius. The second use of the this keyword is when I have a variable, a local variable with the same name with a data field. So what's the problem with this code? The problem with this code is that it doesn't assign this radius, the formal parameter radius, to the radius data field. Basically, what I'm doing in this statement, I'm assigning from the formal parameter radius the value to the same formal parameter radius. It's like basically assigning to the variable x the value of the variable x. So how can we actually bypass the current method to say that I want the radius data field of the current object and not the formal parameter? I can use the this keyword with that period notation. So this is used for two things: to access the current object data fields when they are hidden. And the second reason is to call another constructor from the current constructor. But we will talk more about this later. Now, the next question is, why did we call setRadius with -4? Because we can. So the problem is that we are writing classes that can be used by anyone. And we want to make sure that those people that use our classes don't create objects with meaningless parameters, with data, meaningless data fields. So I just wanted to show an example that somebody could actually call the setRadius method with a negative radius, which is meaningless. But this doesn't have any effect to that object, because in the setRadius method, we can do checks. We can actually find out if that radius that was passed is positive, and only then assign the radius, new radius to radius. Otherwise, it would be ignored. So this is a class with data fields, with constructors, and then with instance methods that are basically used for this specific class. And one thing that you notice in this entire class is that none of these data fields or methods are static. Now, you can use static for things that are used in common for the entire class. Like, for instance, I can define a static integer count initialized with 0 when the program starts. I don't need to do that, because basically data fields have default values. Unless initialized, basically they have a default value. And the default value for reference types is null. The default value for any number type is 0 or 0.0 for real numbers. And default, let's say that I have also another data field, private car C, and the default value for a character type is the Unicode with Unicode 0 and the private Boolean maybe is field for, which again has a default value of false. So data fields, as opposed to local variables, have default values. All of them have default values. I was telling you about static. So you can have static fields that are connected to the class itself. And what they are used for, properties that are in common to all circles. For instance, I want to count how many circles were created. So I can actually, every time somebody calls a constructor, even the default constructor or the constructor with radius, because of the fact that we call the same constructors with no parameters always, basically, after I create a bunch of circles, I can find out how many circles I created of that class. So in this case, I can print circle.count. So that's a static data field, and it will tell me that I created integer count. I think it was not saved. So it basically tells me that I have two objects of the type circle created. Okay, if I have more circles, you will see that the more circles I have, the more objects are created. So if I have circle 3, 4, 5, and 6, then when I run this program, it tells me that I have 6 circles created. So I can have data fields that are static, and I can have methods that are static, like for instance, static integer, or even public, static integer get count, which returns the count. So now I can actually, for this method, I can either get the count if it's non-private, or I can get the count if I have a method that is static. Okay. So I see that I have the same number of circles, 6 circles created. Okay. But we'll learn all of that in time. So for the moment, we got what is the most important thing, that we can create classes and we can initialize those classes for multiple objects. And each object has its own behavior, has its own status, state. Okay. Now, I told you at the beginning that there are what are called UML class diagrams. UML class diagrams is unified. It's a visual language that allows me to actually create and present to a customer the classes that I'm using. And if you looked at the lab for today and tomorrow, those of you that have a lab tomorrow, you will basically see that I gave you two different tools that you can use for making UML diagrams. The first tool is draw.io. It's basically an online tool that allows you to actually draw these diagrams and put them in Google Drive. You can create a new diagram. You can use the blank diagram. You can use the root folder. It seems to me that I need to recreate. Okay. So here you can basically, one of the types of diagrams that you can build are UML diagrams. So UML diagrams allow you to basically create a class. And in this class, you can set, this is, let's say, the circle class. And in the circle class, I have multiple data fields. So the radius of the type double. Maybe I have other types of other data fields. And then I have methods. So always start with the constructors. So in our class, we have the public class, plus stands for public, minus for private. Circle, it doesn't return anything because it's one of the constructors. Then I have the second constructor for circle. So circle that takes a double radius of the type double. The notation that is used for UML diagrams is the variable first, colon, and then the type. I also have the get area method. It takes no parameters because it's basically for this specific circle and returns a double. Then I have other methods. I have get parameter that returns a double. I have set radius that takes a radius of the type double and returns void. Then I have get radius that returns a double. So these are a bunch of a bunch of a class that I can create. Now, I can have as many classes as I want. So for instance, I can create a different class. Let's say that this is about people. So I have the class person, and the class person has multiple data fields. So I will start with first name. Minus means private. So this is of the type string. Then I have last name. And last name is of the type string. And so on. Basically, then I have the constructors of the class and so on. Okay. Now, if you use your own computer, I recommend a different tool called Violet. Oops. It's basically a Java application. And again, it has different types of diagrams. The diagrams that we are using are called class diagrams. And similar to draw.io, you can basically create classes. So let's actually do the class person with its attributes. First name, type string, maybe last name of the type string. Then I have constructors, maybe. Let's say that I have a constructor that I only know the first name of the person. And maybe I have a different constructor in which I have both values, the first name and the last name. In both applications, you can export after you are done the, let's say that I have get first name into an image UML diagrams. So get first name returns a string. Now, the good part about UML diagrams is that you can also use relationships between classes. So let's say that I want to create another class, maybe a subclass of person that inherits everything from person, but has additional properties. So I can create a class student, and the student has, in addition to first name, also GPA of the type double. And I have constructors for student, and the student I can create with a first name, the type string, and a GPA type double. Okay. And then I have other methods, like for instance, get GPA that returns a double. Now, to say that the class student is a subclass of person, we use an arrow. That means that student is a subclass of person. And maybe I have other subclasses of person, like for instance, employee. So employee has a salary of the type double. And is also a subclass of a person, it extends person. So in this tool, you can save the result, so you can actually save it. I will save it, let's say, on the desktop if I find it. Yeah, so it saves in HTML, so I can call it, this is the person UML diagram. You can export it into an image. So the default is PNG, you should change to JPEG. Let's call it also person. And it basically saved it as a person object image on my screen. Okay. Similarly, in draw.io, you can basically, this is saved automatically to your Google Drive, but you can basically export it as an image to your screen. In your lab today, you should try both tools. This way, you basically can see how to do this yourself. Okay, So here we have an image of the UML diagram.
Professor, quick question.
Yep.
Are we to download this from, are we specifically Violet? Are we to download it from SourceForge?
Yes. So here, draw.io is a website, and the Violet tool is on SourceForge. Actually, it's not on SourceForge, it's some website in France.
Okay, got it. Thank you.
Somebody is asking if minus stands for it's minus stands for private, plus stands for public. Where do you use this UML diagram? It's actually the first step when you design a class. So basically, you will use it for presenting what do you want to build. You basically want to build this set of classes and these objects. Okay. So you have UML class diagrams are used in any project. The first phase is the requirement analysis document and the design document. These are two documents that present all the use cases of the project and then all of the design structures in the project. And UML class diagrams are used in this design document. One thing that you may have noticed when I opened Violet for the first time, it asked me what kind of diagram do I want to use. And what type of diagram is called use case diagrams. So use case diagrams basically is basically all the possible uses of the current application. So basically you have use cases for actors, for the users of the project. So for instance, one classic example is ATM withdrawal. So what happens when a person withdraws money from a bank? And there are multiple use cases there. So one is authentication. After authentication, you specify the amount. Then the system will check if the bank balance has enough money for that authentication. In this class, we are not going to do use case diagrams. Use case diagrams are for CSE 316 when we actually develop large projects. In this class, we are only going to develop class diagrams. Is there anything different between UML from the draw.io? So there are many notations for UML class diagrams. The type of relationships that you have from between classes, there are many different notations. You see here, there are this diamond, which basically means that is an aggregate object, or full diamond being a composed object. There are relationships one to many. One such notation is called the crowfoot, in which you are showing that you have many, you have a one class, and this class associates with the other class in a certain manner. So let me show you an example, actually. Let me delete all of these classes. So for instance, I want to build a class car. Okay, so a car. The class car is composed out of multiple wheels. Wheels. And it's an array of wheel. Okay. So now I have a class wheel. And with some properties, maybe diameter, let's say, the wheel, width of the wheel, and so on. So what's the relationship between car and wheel? It's a composition relationship. Basically, the fact that a car has multiple wheels. And usually this composition also means that when you destroy the, let's say a car is totaled, all the components must be also totaled. So this is a relationship, okay? It's a type of relationship that says that this is a component, a part of the car. There is another type of relationship. Let's say that I have a class course, and the course has multiple students. And also it's an array of student. And I have a class student. And whatever properties a student has. So now this is an aggregate. So the course has multiple students. It's not a composition because when, let's say the course ends, is not the end of the students. It's basically a different type of relationship. And in different UML diagram tools, you will find different such notations. So you can see here the notations that are completely different than the ones in Violet. So dispatch is one notation, return, relationships, and so on. There are also notations about that actually are specifying the relationship using the thickness of the edge between these classes. Okay. Good. So let's start with coding. So we start with constructors. So constructors are special methods to create objects of that type. The constructors must have the same name with the class itself. So in the class of circle, we have circle constructors. The constructors do not have a return type in Java, not even void. You're not actually, void is not correct because you are actually returning, you're invoking the constructor with a new operator and you are returning an object of that class. Constructors are invoked using the new operator, like we did new circle or new string, and an object is created and a reference is returned to the variable. So for instance, if you have a class with a class name, you define a variable O, this was a reference, a null reference, and then you assign to it the address, the reference to the new object of the class name. So for instance, circle is my circle is equal with a new circle of radius of 5. Okay. So really what's happening when this line is executed is that first we have a null reference. So if you have this statement in Java, So I have this, that's not one. So I have that statement in Java. First of all, circle is a reference, it's not one of the 8 primitive types. So my circle will be basically an address. This new circle actually creates a circle in the heap. So this will be an object, some object of the type circle. And it has a radius, and that radius in this case is equal with 5. And my circle will be the address that refers to that circle in memory. Okay. So basically here I have a circle of radius of 5 and this is reference to that circle. Maybe later to the same variable, my circle, we assign a different circle, new circle of 10. So what happens in that case? Basically, this new circle of 10 creates a new circle object also in the heap. So again, we have, this is an object of the type circle with some radius of 10. And we are now modifying the reference, is not anymore pointing to the old circle, but is pointing by this assignment to the new circle. Okay. And this is basically a new reference. One question that you may ask is, what happens with the whole circle? So in all programming languages, like for instance in C++, you were supposed to first delete. So my circle, you would first call delete to delete that object, and that basically will reset the my reference to null, and it will garbage collect this object from memory. In Java, you don't need to do this. Basically, Java takes care of this for you. Okay. So what happens is that this object, because there is no more variable in the stack that points to it, is garbage. And Java virtual machine has a process that runs in parallel with your program called the garbage collector. And what it does, it deletes objects that are no more used in your heap. So what the garbage collector does, it gets rid of that for you. Okay. Another thing that may happen is that somebody else writes an assignment. So for instance, we may have something of this kind. Circle, your circle is assigned to my circle. So what happens in this case, it's assigning an object to another object, copies the reference. So your circle becomes a reference to exactly the same object that was referred by my circle. Okay. So basically, now you have two objects, my circle and your circle, that are referring to the same circle. So why is this important? Is that now you can use either one to access that circle. So you can actually do your circle dot radius or set radius to, let's say, 15. And now if somebody does system.out.print of my circle dot radius, basically I see the same circle, so it will print 15. Because basically what happened is that I modified this radius from 10 to 15. Okay. So both variables are looking at the same circle. Okay. Your circle is equal to my circle, is just copying the reference of my circle into your circle. So modifying either one's radius will modify both of them's radius. Okay. That's it. That's important. Can you access the garbage collector? No, you cannot. What you could do, so one thing that will trigger the garbage collector to destroy that object is that you explicitly assign to your variable. So in this example, I assign to my circle null. So if you do something like this, that will automatically, will be a suggestion to the garbage collector that you should delete that object because it's not referred by my circle anymore. But still internally, what happens is that the object has a reference count. Basically, most of these programming languages, they know how many references are to this object. So basically, it will know that even if my circle is not pointing anymore at the object, I decrement the reference count, but there is another reference pointing to it. Okay. Another methodology of actually doing garbage collector internally in Java JVM is actually to, it's what is called mark and sweep. So first of all the objects in the heap are marked as not used. Then the stack is unrolled. So basically all the references from the stack are followed to the heap, and the mark is changed from unused to used. And when I finish with the entire stack, I go back, and those objects that do not have, that are still unused, are garbage collected. But these are methodologies to do garbage collector. It's already done by Java. We don't do it ourselves explicitly. Okay, good. Now, so these are constructors. They are methods that have the same name with the class itself. They do not have a return type. They actually return an object of the class. They are invoked with a new operator, and you create basically a new object in the heap, and you copy the reference to that object into the variable. A class may actually be declared without constructors, in which case a default constructor with empty body is implicitly declared in the class. So all the classes that you defined this semester actually had a no argument constructor. Okay. So one of the classes that we used in many, many classes was this class test. Okay. It has a main method, but by default, it has a default constructor. So I can write test T1 is equal with a new test with no arguments. And there is no error. In fact, I can create as many as I want of these objects, maybe T2, T3, T4, T5, T6, T7, T8. And these are all correct. My class totally works fine because by default, you have a default constructor. So remember this, that a class that is declared without constructors have implicitly a no argument constructor with an empty body. Now, in fact, what happens is that if you define another constructor, like for instance, I define test that takes an integer, okay, that actually invalidates the fact that there is a default constructor. So now I have 8 errors in my code because I have another constructor, which is not the default constructor, and this sentence here only says that a class without constructors has a default constructor. But if it has constructors, then it doesn't have a default constructor. You must explicitly define one. So how can I fix this? I can define a test empty constructor. And now that basically fixes this problem because now I explicitly have a default constructor. And again, my program runs without problems. It doesn't print anything because I just create objects that don't do anything. So that's basically what this sentence says, that a class declared without constructor has a default no argument constructor with an empty body, implicitly declared. But if it has at least one constructor, then it's not the case that if that is the default constructor. So you may not have a default constructor if you already wrote some constructor in your class. Now, how do you access the data fields of your class? You can use the dot operator. So you can use your reference variable dot and then the data field. So that's how we did with circles. My circle.radius will be a way to access the radius, to assign a new value to it or to read its value. If it's public or if it's default modified and I'm accessing it from a class in the same package. You can use the same notation to call methods. So object reference dot method name with arguments, like for instance, my circle.getArea. So again, it has to have the correct visibility. If you call this method must be public or default modified, in which case you can only call it from a class in the same package. So let's see an example. So I create, what happens in this little code? I circle my circle is equal with a new circle of 5. So first of all, my circle is defined of the type circle. So my circle is a null reference. Then new circle of 5 creates a circle of radius of 5 in the heap. And the assignment will copy the address of that circle into the variable, the reference variable, my circle. And similarly, your circle is created and it has a null value. Then new circle creates a circle with radius of 1. And the assignment copies the address of that circle into the reference variable, your circle. And then you can access the data field in case that the data field radius is public or default modified, and we are accessing it. This code is in a class in the same package. I can do your circle.radius is equal with 100. And that modifies the radius from 1 to 100. Now, non-static versus static methods. So non-static or instance methods are those methods that you invoke with objects like getArea, either for your circle or my circle. They instance variables belong to a specific object, and instance methods, non-static methods, are invoked for an instance of the class like my circle or C1 or C2. Static methods is everything that we have defined this semester up to this class. They are shared by all instances of the class. They are not tied to a specific object. You invoke them with the name of the class, like math.pow is. Pow is a method in a static method in the math class, and you can invoke it as with math.pow. You can also have static constants or static variables, like my count that I used in the circle is a static variable that is used for counting how many objects of that class circle are created. Another thing about Java is that you remember that Java assigns no default value to local variables. So if you have a code like this in the main method, integer x, string y, and then you have system.out.println x is and the value of x, or y is and the value of y, you will get compilation errors in both lines. It will tell you that these variables are not initialized yet, but it assigns default values to data fields. So here is another example, which defines a class student with four data fields, name of the type string, age of the type int, is science major of the type Boolean, and gender of the type car. And you can create a class test in the same package with a main method in which you create a student object using the default constructor. And if you print the name of the student, it will print null because that's a reference type variable. If you print the age, it will print student.age will print 0, showing the fact that integers or any numbers have a default value of 0. Booleans have a default value of false. So if you are printing student.is science major, it will print false. And for gender, it will print the character with Unicode 0, which is invisible. So basically, data fields have default values as opposed to local variables, which will trigger compiler errors when you don't assign anything to them, but then you are using them in a assignment on the right hand side or a print statement like here. Okay. Now, all of the classes are what are called reference types. That means that when we define a variable of a class type, that variable contains the address of the object that is created in memory. And that's different than primitive variables, which actually contain the value itself. So if I write something like integer I equal with 1, I is a location in memory, is an alias to a location in memory that actually contains the value 1. But if I write circle C is equal with a new circle, it will basically C is a reference to the object of the type circle that is created in the heap. So there are only 8 primitive types, and they contain directly the values, and we discussed them in many previous classes. And everything else in Java are objects, like including arrays are actually stored in the same way. They are basically a reference to where the object, the array is stored in memory. Similarly for objects, they are addresses or of where those are stored in memory. Now, another example that I showed you was if you have a type assignment for primitive types, like basically I is equal with J. So maybe I was one and J was two. They were integers before this assignment. After the assignment, I is two and J is two. If you modify any one of them afterwards, it will only modify that one. So for instance, if you say now J is equal to three, J becomes three, but I is still two. For objects, it's not like that, because the objects themselves, like C1 and C2, my circles, are addresses of circles. So C1 may be the address of a circle with radius of 5, and C2 is an address of a circle with radius of 9. If after assignment of C1 equals C2, basically C1 will have the same reference as C2. So we copy the address from C2 into C1. Now both C1 and C2 are looking at the same object in memory. So basically you have two references to the same object. And this is very important because now you can change C1 dot radius is equal to 3. C2's radius is also 3 because they are both looking at the same object in memory. What happened with the old object? It became garbage. Nobody is looking at it. Nobody has its reference anymore. So that object previously referenced by C1 is called garbage in Java, and garbage is automatically collected by the JVM. And this was a big improvement to have an automatic garbage collector, because before that, you would have what are called memory leaks, that one would create objects, but it wouldn't deallocate them. So in C, actually for creating a structure, you would have to create, or even an array, you would have to allocate space with malloc. And then to delete it when it's no more referenced, you would have to deallocate that specific location. In C++, there were the new and delete operators. So basically you had to create a new object and delete it explicitly. Java already got rid of deletion. Basically it's done automatically by the system. So now we'll talk about a few of the standard classes in Java. So the first class is date class. It's in the Java util package, and it allows you to create a date object for a specific moment in time, a millisecond in time. So internally, it actually stores the date as a single long value, which is the number of milliseconds elapsed since January 1st, 1970 GMT, which basically is called the Unix epoch time. That's basically some moment in time that all of these date objects are basically the number of milliseconds from that specific time. Okay. It has methods for printing the date. So for instance, for printing the date, you can get a string representation of the date, and that will tell you basically what's the current date. So let me actually show this to you. So let me delete this. So now we can create a date object. I will use the default constructor. So D is equal to the new date. And now I have to import it from Java util package. And I can print out system.out.print the date to string. So basically this prints that today is Thursday, March 18th, 5:55 Eastern Daylight Saving Time. Okay. You can create other dates, so another object, and we can invoke its toString method. Maybe this is the date D2, and we print D2. Okay. So it prints that second object. That here, so it looks like two different dates. See? Good. Another object in Java, which is used for generating random numbers, is javautil.random. It has a different function, pseudo-random function, than the one that is used in math.random. So there is a constructor, there is a default constructor, there is a constructor with a seed in which you can pass in an integer value as a long, and it will be used in that internal function to generate random values. So it has a different function than math.random, and you can basically generate, it has methods to generate integers, like for instance, generate 10 integers between 0 and 1000, not including 1000. So it returns an integer value between 0 and n, excluding n. Similarly, there is a next double that returns between 0 and 1, excluding 1, or next float, which returns a float between 0 and 1, excluding 1. So it's basically a random number generator. And you can generate as many as you want random numbers. As I said, it has a different function, is different than math.random. Not better, just different, a different way to get a random number in which your input of the seed is also taken into consideration. Static variables, I told you about them, that you can define a number of objects as a static value. In the UML diagram, we underline or we use just a static a keyword in front of the type of the data field. So for instance, here, if I have a static data field, let me actually put it in violet. Let's say that I want to count the number of cars. I can say that there is a static variable count, and it's of the type integer. So because I cannot underline, I basically use a label saying that this is static. So a static data field is basically a data field that is shared by all the objects of that type. And you can use it for counting the objects. So they all share the same value. The value is actually stored in the class, not in any object in particular, as opposed to instance variables like radius, which are different for every one of the objects, like circle one and circle two. And now we get to visibility modifiers. So by default, your class or variable or method can be accessed by any class in the same package. Public makes the class, method, or data visible to any class in any package. Private makes the data or method accessible only from the current class, only from the declaring class. And if the data is private, we need get and set methods to read and modify private properties. And we saw that in the case of radius. But let me give you an example, a bigger example. So consider that I have a class C1 defined in the package P1 that has a public data field X, a default or package level. Default means that there is no modifier in front of it, a variable Y, and a private variable Z. And similarly, I have a public method M1, a default or package modified method M2, and a private method M3. From another class C2, also in the package P1, I can create an object O of the type C1 using the new constructor of C1, and I can access the public data field X. I can access with the dot notation the default modified or package level modified variable Y, but I cannot access the private data field. And similarly, I can invoke the method M1, that because it's public, the method M2 because it's default modified and I'm in the same package, but I cannot access the method M3 because it's private. So the default modifier gives you access to all classes within the same package. The private modifier is only, that data field is only available in that class and nowhere else. And public is unrestricted access from any class in any package. For instance, if I have the class C2 in the package P2, I can still create an object of the class C1 if I precede the class with the package P1 because it's in a different package. And I can access the public data field, but not the default data field or the private data field. And similarly, I can invoke the method M1 because it was public, but I cannot invoke the method M2 that was default modified, or M3 that was private. If a class is defined as default modified and I have another class in the same package like C2 that is public, I can access, use the class C1 because it's in the same package. But from another class C3, I cannot access the default modified class C1 if C3 is in the package P2, different than P1. I can only access those classes from package P1 that are public. So minus stands for what is called encapsulation, means that the data field is private. And in order to access the data field, I will need get methods and set methods. Get is to get the value, set is to set to a different value, and put constraints. What do you accept as inputs? And finally, the last thing that I want to tell you is that you can create arrays of objects. So for instance, I can create an array, circle array of circles. And this is a new circle array of 10 circles. Basically, the circle array is a reference to an array of references, circle of 0, circle of 1. And if I want, actually, at the beginning, those circles are all null. But if I want, I can actually create a circle. So any one of those, I can do circle array and the index, and then create a new circle, like for instance, new circle the default radius. That's how this second reference happens, basically, that I get that circle of 0 is a reference to a circle object. And similar for the other circles. Basically, I have circle of 1 is a new circle with some radius and so on. So today, what I want you to do in the lab is to actually design one class rectangle that represents a rectangle, has two data fields, width and height. Draw the UML diagram for it. Basically, draw the data field separately, and then the constructors in the methods, accesses and mutators for every one of the data fields. I also have a data field color of the type string, a get area method and get perimeter method, and then implement a test class program that creates two rectangles, one with width of 4 and 40, and one with width of 3.5 and height of 35.9. And make basically print the different objects with the different properties. You can submit the UML diagram as a as an image, like a JPEG, or you can archive it, compress it into a zip file. So you can basically do, on my machine, I have 7-zip, but you should basically maybe install 7-zip if you have Windows to create, to compress it. But I don't want it. I basically, what I want is the figure. And you can submit that into Blackboard together with the Java file. That's all for today. Any questions? We are right on time, 6:05.
Professor, so if we give you a file with the Java, the Java file and the UML charts in the same zip file, that's enough? Or
yes, I'm not yes, sure. Yes. You can submit them as one zip, or you can submit them as separate JPEG, and then add the additional file for the Java file. Yeah.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Welcome. Okay, that's all for today. Thank you very much. And see you next class.
Thank you, Professor. See you next time.
Thank you, Professor. Have a good day.